Take vacation to Malaysia. You my baby, the paparazzi flashing crazy. She swallowed the bottle while I sit back and smoke gelato. Walking my mansion, 20,000 patent Picasso. Be dipping, dabbing like a nacho. Took up a pen and diamond dancing like Rick Ricardo. She having it with the color working on the bachelor. I know you got a pass, I got a pass that's in the back of us. Average, I'ma make a million on the average. I'm riding with no brain, I'm out of it.
Do you slide on all your nights like this? Do you try on all your nights like this? Some spotlight on the slide.
Oh, Save those conversations till the end. Thank you. Again, my name's Christian Ross.
And I'm Kristen Slink.
We are your hosts for this evening for Atlanta Startup Village number 90.
90. That's a lot.
That's a whole lot.
That's a whole lot.
And so we want to thank our sponsor again, SCI. Thank you so much.
He's right over there.
Hi, John. Thank you so much for sponsoring. So that lovely beer that you had is due to him.
Yes, thank you.
So, little housekeeping items, too. We want to say thank you to our perpetual sponsor, which is Atlanta Tech Village, which you are here right now. There are tons of startups that are housed in this building. There's a lot of great events, so make sure you check Eventbrite if you want to keep up with events that are going on, ways to improve your business. Something is always happening in this building, that's for sure.
Yeah. The place to be.
It is the place to be. Yeah. In addition to our thank you to ATV, we also want to thank the original host that had done, I think, the 70-some episodes, or 80, which is John Birdsong and Allie Merritt. So Allie Merritt is the managing director here, and John Birdsong is a VC now with Atlanta Ventures. And, of course, it takes a village to put something like that on. This beer doesn't pour itself. It doesn't get here by itself. So thank you to our Atlanta Tech Village team in the back. DJ T is going to be spinning the beats, keeping us hyped throughout each pitch. And actually, if you see on the screen, speaking of It Takes a Village, cohort number 11 is having their graduation and demo day. That is a pre-accelerator that's right here in Atlanta Tech Village. They're having their demo day this Wednesday. So go on Eventbrite. Feel free to come out, support those startups, learn what they're doing. It is 6 to 8 p.m. You can also scan the QR code that'll be going on throughout the evening. So we know what you came here for. What'd they come here for?
Pitching!
They came here for pitches. Pitch, please. I'm sorry, y'all.
You could have helped yourself.
I couldn't. We have four companies that are going to come on the stage, and today's audience winner will be the last company that'll be in our pitch-off Monday, June 26th. They will have the opportunity in that pitch-off to take home two hot desks and parking for a year. How much is that worth, Kristen?
$13,000.
Say what?
Yes.
$13,000.
It's tremendous value, and you get to see all your friends all the time.
It's
fabulous.
Exactly.
Hot seat means you get to work here, so work with your friends.
And they will join. So actually, whoever wins this evening, whoever becomes your audience favorite, you are going to vote at the end. We are going to put it up, the poll. You will not be able to vote before the end. They will join Carpool Logistics, Merch Shop AI, Jax, and Strapped in the pitch off. But first, we want to welcome Ian to the stage. He's pitch number one.
Woo!
We have four companies. We have PayRego, Quickie, Roots, okay, and Supercopy. Yeah, we got vibes up in here, y'all.
And then also, I know we have a lot of first-timers here as well, so after the pitch, it opens up for Q&A where you guys get to ask the questions. So as you're listening to the pitches, this gives you the opportunity to ask the founders exactly what you want to know about their business. So prepare those questions, and then we'll go around and get you asking them.
Yes, you do. You do need a mic. Let's get you one. All right, guys, let's give it up for Ian with PayRego.
Hi, I'm Ian. I'm the founder of a company, Indeed, based here in the Atlanta Tech Village, and our first product is called PayRego. I hopefully put the pronunciation for you up there, but I think in the interest of your safety, it's kind of important that I warn all of you that talking about software development tools very easily can cause narcoleptic fits in many people. So you've been warned, okay? So I just thought I'd start with a little bit about me real quick. I got out of Georgia Tech. How many Georgia Tech alumni have I got here? Not as many as I might have expected. Okay, good for you. That was the Georgia Tech alumni. How many of you remember the 20th century? Oh, and not that many, actually. I got out in 1998 with a PhD in computer science. And in fact, I'm recovering pretty nicely from that, I think. Also, I quit my day job to do this full-time back in September, and in case you believed anything on the internet before, you definitely should not now. So if you come into the community room where I sit, like, you know, at 10 o'clock on a Friday night, and I'm still sitting there pounding on my keyboard, you're going to be like, what are you doing? And I'm going to be like, big deadline on Monday, the boss says we could lose this client, if the software doesn't get fixed, our app is, like, crashing or whatever. So that's what you think I'm doing. You think I'm sitting there trying to fix our application to get it to work. But in fact, that's not what I'm doing. I'm actually debugging, I don't know, a dozen or maybe 15 or 10 different programs, because what has happened in the software business is the world has changed to be something called microservices. It's a way of building your app by breaking it into a bunch of small pieces and running them on a network, and they all talk to each other to give the app its functionality. Well, in case you needed any help, that's a lot harder. I mean, just think about the number of new ways that 12 programs can fail compared to just one, right? The world is really painful if you have to do this. And this is what happens when the people on the bottom are making these choices. If you are an actual software developer or maybe a first or second level manager, you're probably already going, yeah, I have this problem. So the trick, then, what PayRego does is it allows you to do the simple case when you're actually doing the development. So your developer gets a world which is the simple case, and you can deploy it in the complicated case without changing your code. So PayRego is an API and infrastructure for making your life not suck when you're a developer and still get your deployments as microservices, which is a big plus. If you're curious from a pure status standpoint, I've got the code working. The infrastructure is in place. It's not ready for prime time by any stretch of the imagination, but I've proven that the basic trick here can work. So some of you are probably asking, all of you thinking about dollar signs are asking, well, is there a market here? Is this like so super niche that maybe it doesn't matter? Well, I started out on this journey because I had the pain myself, right? I actually had this pain. I was a software developer. I was a software manager. I know how painful this is and when it becomes your job. By the way, the results on pain are excellent. That was not a reference to Stanley Milgram, by the way, not at all. Initial target customer that I'm trying to get my hands on are people who do contract software development. Why? Because they have the problem more. They do lots of things with microservices. If it makes you feel any better, 81% of the United States' companies say they're either using microservices already in their software development or they will in the near future. So this problem is pretty pervasive. The 157 in the Atlanta area tells you how many companies are doing contract software development. So it's a pretty big piece of surface area. So what I'm going to do is ask you something. I'm trying to figure out if there's really a market here. We've got some indicators, we've got some pain, we're not totally sure. So I'm asking you to hook me up with somebody you know who's a software developer, or perhaps even better, a manager of software developers, because I want to talk to them, and I do that usually by 15 or 20 minutes semi-structured interviews, so it's not too much of a pain for them, and hopefully I'll discover that, in fact, there's a great market for this coming. Okay, thanks. Bye.
Who has questions for Ian? And Ian... And Ian, when someone asks a question, please repeat it. Thank you.
That's a good question. She asks, what kind of testing was I referring to in my slide when I said testing? She mentions regression testing. Is that correct? It's actually sort of testing in general, because let me just tell you, if you got 12 services that interact over a network, testing them is a nightmare, because even just getting them all up is hard, right? To say nothing of having a reproducible test path. So the answer is, we give you the reproducible test path by doing the single case. So in principle, it should work for any kind of test. Yeah. Yeah, it's a great question. In fact, this guy actually must have seen an earlier draft of my slides, because by far the biggest expense of running a software development group is the salaries. It's at least an order of magnitude larger, probably more like a factor of 50 larger than all other expenses. So what we're trying to do from a purely dollars and cents standpoint is make the software developers, well, I would say make their lives suck less. And you would hope that's going to produce more efficiency. Measuring that is, I don't know how many of you have ever seen talks about measuring the efficiency of software developers. That turns out to be a very difficult problem, fraught with peril. But that's where we're headed, is we're going to make your software developers more efficient, and they are your biggest cost when you're building software. In the back. He asked, are you going back to monoliths or are you actually doing microservices? Is that fair? So the answer is both, because we want to give you the developer experience of a monolith and we want to give you the deployment experience of microservices. And we do that without changing the code. So it's a purely infrastructure trick that allows you to do this. That's a great question. There's $20 in it for you. Yeah, that's where I'm assuming you're going to be running your microservices. Right now, I do it on mostly Azure.
Can you repeat the question?
Oh, sorry.
Thank you.
He says, what kinds of clouds is it that you support for the deployments? Right now, I do it on Azure because I'm cheap and they threw $25,000 of credit at me. So I said, okay, easy decision. There's no principled reason, though. This is really a pretty... It's a pretty mid-level hack, so there's no real good reason you can't do this on any of those clouds. Now, I can't prove that right now, but that was what I would say. Wow, we got a surprising number of people awake. Somebody was, yep. Yeah. I mean, I have a demo that works, yeah. Do you want to see it? What'll happen is it'll print a number on the screen and I'll go, success. I'm just kidding, sorry. Well, so let me repeat the question. What kind of tool is it? He's asking, is it like an IDE? Is it a production tooling? Is that fair? And the answer is it's actually infrastructure. So it runs basically underneath your code and allows us to do these switcheroo tricks so that you can develop in one way and deploy in another. So it's all done between your program and the operating system. That's where it sits. So it's not either of those. We don't care what IDE you use, for example. Well, it depends on how problematic your development process is. I'll just give you a simple example. Do you have problems with tests that flake because of your microservices and that you go, oh, just run it again, it'll pass the second time. You ever heard that? That's the kind of problem you get purely because it's a microservice-based architecture. So you want repeatable tests. You want to be able to run a debugger. Imagine that. You can't run a debugger on 20 programs. That's not, I suppose you could. It's not gonna happen. Running it on one program, though, easy. Put your breakpoints in, and it all just works. So that's why.
We've got some questions up in here. Let's give it up for Ian with PayRego.
All right. Don, you want to get yourself set up? So next we have Don with Quickie, but before we do, we have a fun giveaway.
Yeah, we do. Okay. Are you like waving? What was that?
He wants a giveaway.
Oh, that was a giveaway wave. I was like,
it's like, I want it.
The house. I'm sorry. Thought we were at the Usher concert. I didn't know what was going on. Okay. So here is our first question. Actually, no. We'll do this one first for a first timer. So if you're a first timer, why should you get it? Raise your hand. Doing this with you tonight. Not tonight. He's a known one, y'all.
As a first timer, I should get the prize because I was able to connect 5 different people with opportunities tonight.
Ooh. Wow! I don't even know if we need to source another one.
No, that's amazing.
You get a tote.
Tote these, no joke. I did not mean to say that out loud. I am.
Looper.
I just want you to know that's exactly what this event is here for. It is meant to be connections and for you to meet people and understand, like, maybe you find your co-founder, maybe you find a client. There's so many different opportunities in this room, and I'm so sorry I was just inappropriate. So here we go. Actually, speaking of inappropriate, here's Quickie.
Thank you. That was a pretty good segue, actually. All right, everybody, I'm Don Charlton. So I'm a tech entrepreneur, full stack software developer, product designer. It's my second company. I started a company called Jazz HR back in 2008. And we grew it to 20 million, sold it for 180 million. I've raised venture capital, angel, all that kind of stuff through the years. Question, how many people were you able to connect with today? I just want you to just think about that number. It's about a couple hundred people in this room. Think about the number of people you connected with today. Second question, how many people were you unable to connect with today? Think about that many. Now, raise your hand if you plan on raising money at some point in the next 2 years. Now, keep your hands up. Keep your hand up if you met me today. I'm an angel investor, an active angel investor. Guess what? Missed connections equal missed opportunities. And at events like this, every time you come to Atlanta Tech Village, you have far more missed connections than you do actually making meeting new people and creating new opportunities. That's because professional networking doesn't scale. It doesn't scale in person. There could be 5,000 people in this room, 500 or 50. You're lucky if you meet 50. You're really good at networking. It doesn't work online, and we're going to talk about LinkedIn in a second because LinkedIn has failed at that. And it doesn't work anywhere. Even when you build a network, we don't have 30 minutes for every single person to kind of stay connected, figure out if maybe there is a possible ability for us to do work together and so forth. And as I said, LinkedIn is not the solution. It's too unfocused. I got 2,600 people in my network. I don't know where I met them from. I don't know how to filter them by where I met them. I don't know how to leverage them. And I certainly don't know why I connected with probably 2,000 of them. It's too impersonal. This is a real message I got from someone. So the hell what? I'm not going to connect with you because I don't know who you are. You're an avatar about this big on the screen. Why would I want to connect with you? What do you want from me? And if this isn't true, if I just circle InMail and everybody knows how you should feel about InMail, if you guys think InMail is amazing, I'm just going to like put the microphone down and go on vacation and never start another company again. We all know why. LinkedIn is too spammy. Neglected networks grow stale and eventually they become worthless. Professional networking is something we all know is important, but we don't really do it. You guys didn't really do a lot of networking here. It's very difficult to scale. It requires social interactions you're not really ready to do necessarily. Proximity and serendipity are the biggest reasons why we actually achieve meeting new people. I want to reimagine online professional networking. Yes, I'm going after LinkedIn. I might as well do something big. It's time to move away from the antiquated LinkedIn experience to something that looks more like this, authentic and effective, and that's Quickie. It's a new way for professionals to network quickly and effectively using short video messages, no apps required. You can use it in the browser, you can use it on your phone. And the idea is when meeting in person is impractical or impossible and you want to keep that connection fresh, you want to ask a question, you want to get advice and so forth, send somebody a 30-second video instead of trying to request a 30-minute meeting. How Quickie works. One, you join one of the networks. We have our own networks, which are going to be based on interest and then geography. You then network. You have 30 seconds to impress. 30-second greeting for what you do, or a 30-second greeting requesting to connect to somebody. And once connected, you can connect with that person one video message at a time. So let's jump into a quick demo. First, I'm going to go to my connections. So these are connections that I've already made. So let's say if I haven't spoken to Terry in about 4 months, and I want to ask Terry a quick question. I can click this, click on new video message, and click record. Recording, recording, recording. I click done.
Recording, recording, recording.
I click send message, and then there's his video. Or I can browse one of the many different networks, and I can watch video messages from other people.
Hey, Don. My name is Mitch. I'm part of a media group putting together a roundtable discussion.
So you can see here, and I can also send out requests to people as well. Because I have 18 seconds left, I'm going to jump back to the slides because I'm not good at this. And very quickly, we're not out raising money right now. Revenue model is premium features. Basically branding and so forth. Current state, I put $600K of my own money in. We raised $1 million. We're in the market, small team, strong pipeline of sales. And I always like to say, if you can't meet, there's always time for a quickie. If you want to sign up today, you can scan that barcode. We're active, we're live. And let's try to revolutionize professional networking, okay? Thanks a lot.
Who has questions for Don with Quickie? I think I did sit you up there.
Yep, right here. So the question is, how did I come up with the idea, right? Basically, the true story is I was working on a product for remote companies, and then this little thing called the fucking pandemic hit, and it made me really think hard about what are problems that professionals have that could be solved through asynchronous video that wasn't Loom, right? So basically, think of us as kind of like LinkedIn with Loom kind of built in. and much more focus on actually building authentic human connections through introductions, through requests to connect, and so forth. Yeah, I got a lazy eye, so the white guy. Yeah. What's that? I think my hope is if for some reason, well, the question is, when with the oncoming onslaught of potentially synthetic AI generated people, right, like our own synthetic version of ourselves, how is our product going to operate within that world? I think that we might be, if for some reason that becomes a commonplace thing, like the idea of having a digital version of you, I think we'll be in a great place, because I think that if we are successful and achieve scale, we'll have more video content and audio content of the average professional than anyone else in the world, which means we could say, click a button, with your permission, we'll generate your virtual avatar. And that virtual avatar can then become, you can just type in a video message and send it off to somebody. So if your hair is all messed up, like mine is right now, then you'll be able to not have to be on camera for that. So I think we'd be well positioned if for some reason that becomes mainstream. The lady in front of you. Sorry. From whenever we were a video messaging platform specifically, you have a video message from is highly converting at this point because it's very novel. That doesn't mean over time that won't change. I would argue that right now we're still in the middle of product market fit, and this is definitely a product that has behavior change. So the idea of normalizing the idea that this is where you, like, if I introduce somebody to you, them recording a video explaining why they want to meet with you, those are all very novel concepts that we kind of have to earn users' trust and usage.
And that question was in mail versus video, what the data has been.
Yeah, the question was, how do I have any data on how effective video is for networking? Right there. I think the question was, is it restricted to just video, and is there, and what are some of maybe like the mechanisms around how videos are managed, or? Yeah, like how they're stored and so forth, got it. Yeah, so we're gonna make them ephemeral over time if you want to, because sometimes you might wanna have a sensitive conversation and you want it to delete as soon as someone records it. What was the first part of the question again? Yeah, oh, text, yeah. So we want to add,
and
we're
repeat,
learning from
repeat,
user.
Repeat, please.
I'm sorry?
Repeat for those on YouTube. Oh, at home.
Well, the question was, can you only respond through video? And the answer is right now, yes, but we're going to add, based on customer feedback, the ability to reply by text, because I might watch your video and I might really want to connect with you when I want to say, hey, sounds great, and I'm gonna grab some time with you. We have other cool features in here too, like you can embed in a video message text about your company, links, and you can even embed like a Calendly calendar. So you can actually use this for like scheduling meetings and so forth. Next up, right there in the red. They would crush me right now for that. That's something that, with the resources and proving that we actually have a product market fit, we will probably hit the wall of saying we're not really supporting those people that well yet, and then we'll just put the resources towards making sure that we do that.
Yeah. And that final question was, how is it supporting accessibility?
Sorry. Yep, sorry.
Thank you so much, John, with Quickie. Yeah.
All right. I definitely signed up, did you?
Yeah, I did.
Yeah. QR codes are great. They were totally not a thing years ago. And
yeah,
now
you remember
like,
that? Remember how
cool.
They went out? You saw QR codes, yeah. You were like, oh my God, whatever. And now you're like,
that's all I have. Yeah, that's all I do now. It's everywhere. Too. Thank you, pandemic.
We have one more giveaway. Actually, we're going to have two more. But we have one more before he gets up there.
Perfect.
Who can name a team that is in the NBA playoffs right now that is not Atlanta? You're right. He shouted it quite quickly, y'all.
Too far back.
Quite quickly.
There you go.
Oh, I got to give you the All right, let's give it up to Clint with Roots.
All right, so my name is Clint, and I am the founder of Roots. We help you set boundaries with your phone and unlock more time for the things you love, so you can be happier, healthier, and more grounded. So I want to try a quick experiment. Just bear with me for a few seconds here. Okay, so how many of you heard a voice in your head telling you to grab your phone during that moment of silence? If you did, don't feel bad. Most of us, anytime we have a free moment, or even when we're in the middle of something important, constantly feel the need to reach for our phones. So let's talk about the elephant in the room. Most of us are addicted to our phones. It's not really even our fault. It's not like we sat down 10 years ago and said, you know what, I would love to stare at my phone for 4 hours a day and mindlessly scroll for hours on end. But this is where we are, and the science shows that it's having a serious impact on our mental and physical health. Some of you may have seen this tweet from Paul Graham. It went viral recently. What it shows is a major spike in mental health problems that matches up perfectly with the release of the iPhone. And that's not to say necessarily that it's the phone's fault. It's more about how we use it. So according to recent surveys, we now check our phones 352 times per day. That's once every 2 minutes and 43 seconds. When you include all the taps, swipes, and scrolls, we're interacting with our phones over 2,500 times per day. It's created a scenario where we're drowning in digital dopamine. And zooming out a bit, we spend about a third of our waking hours staring at our phones. And a majority of that is regrettable screen time. So time spent scrolling on social media. Taking out time for sleep, that's every minute of the day for 13 years of our lives spent scrolling mindlessly. And look, some of the time we spend on our phones is very positive. They empower us to do things that are incredible. But most of us, myself included, really need to find a better balance. And it's not easy. It is not the path of least resistance. So that's where Roots comes in. And a lot of what I've just said may sound a little bit doom and gloom, but there is a big silver lining. By redirecting just half of the time we spend scrolling, we can unlock 50 hours per month. You could read 7 books. You could call every friend and family member that you love. Or you could simply sit back and enjoy a couple days of downtime. And maybe even more importantly, when we do have small breaks in the day, we have an opportunity to give our minds time to unwind instead of filling every gap with a scroll. So we like to think of Roots as a digital Trojan horse. You might think to yourself, how can an app help solve the phone problem? But we feel like it's important to meet people where they are. Our attention is on our phones, so we believe that the solution should live here too. So I'll show you how it works. We aim to do 3 things really well. We set boundaries with your phone, we intercept the mindless scroll, and we make time for the things you love. So getting into the app itself, our home tab quantifies your screen time and daily attention in a beautiful and approachable way. Your daily balance score goes up and down based on how you spend time on your phone, or when you offset your screen time by doing things like stepping outside. Our Insights tab makes the data actionable and suggests app limits and downtime based on your current habits and your intentions. And these limits allow us to intercept the mindless scroll in a way that creates a little bit more friction than the default iOS screen time limits, where you can simply tap and refill the hourglass. And finally, our smart scheduler makes time on your calendar for the things you love and helps you schedule digital downtime throughout the week. So, what's next for us at Roots? We are releasing our private beta this week, and we'd like to invite anybody who is interested to join us. We're closing our pre-seed funding round. It's being led by VF Corp's Venture Foundry. VF Corp is the publicly traded parent company of North Face and Smart Wool. We plan to add one or two more investors to this round. And our immediate focus is on finding 100 customers who are obsessed with our app and iterating towards a public launch. If the mission resonates with you, please reach out. I would love to connect. Thanks for your time, and I hope you enjoy the rest of the night.
Who has questions for Clint?
All right, start here. Yeah, it's a good question. So the question is, in the app productivity space, who are our biggest competitors and what separates us from them? So what's interesting is Apple just opened up the Screen Time API in iOS 16. So this is a fairly new opportunity to be able to use with individuals. In the past, it's had to be parent-child relationships. So the short answer is there's two or three folks that have started working on this. Thinking of a couple names, I think Jomo is one app that does something similar. There's one or two others. Opal is another. But what we think separates us is focusing on the time that you unlock, not just the time that you spend on your phone, and then also executing in a way that is very approachable and beautiful and doesn't make you feel too bad about the time spent on your phone. And I'll say one other thing. We have an awesome team in place that I'm really excited about. And you know, I think with any really interesting market like this, there's going to be other folks playing in it. But you know, we welcome the competition and the other folks that are doing it. I think everybody's trying to solve an interesting problem. So in short, there's two or three other folks that are focusing on this screen time, and certainly a lot of kind of Pomodoro timer type apps out there. But we think we live in a little bit of a different space. So good question. Yeah, second row. Yeah, really good question. So the question was, what are we doing beyond just phones? So when you connect the whole ecosystem of PC and other digital devices, and how do we think about other personas? So teens and kids and parents. So short term, start with the phone. It's where there's a very approachable problem to solve. Long term, we certainly have a vision for being able to bring in habits on your TV, on your computer, and kind of create a more holistic picture. So that is certainly on the radar. And when it comes to kind of kids and parents, I think something that's pretty interesting is, you know, there's the option to take the phone away from your kids, like you said. There's also hard limits where you could kind of manage them instead. But what I think would be interesting is to empower your kids by giving them an app where they can kind of take ownership and do it on their own versus forcing them into something. So I think it's kind of an approach where we're saying, let's be a little bit more empowering to the person who's making the decision. It could be kids, could be teens. And yeah, long term, would love to connect the dots beyond just the phone. So, really good question, Shep. Yeah, question is, how do we think about the revenue model? So we are, as mentioned, about to roll out into private beta. We see it as a freemium model, so we're going to have a certain level of features that everybody can get into. We kind of think of this as like an attention flywheel. So you come in, you measure and quantify your attention. We help you set new intentions, and then we help you optimize towards a new baseline. So what we're thinking is give you a little bit of each of those three pieces of the puzzle in the free version, and then in premium, you can upgrade and get more access to things like the smart calendar or smart recommendations based on the way that you use your phone. All right, yeah, in the back. Good question. Question is, do we have anybody on our team in the social sciences, kind of in the professional world? The short answer is right now we do not have anybody on the team like that, but we plan to try to go out and find some really awesome advisors who can help us on that front. And so the short-term goal is, you know, get in front of 100 awesome customers, really hone in the product, and then kind of go to the next level by bringing in some folks in that are trained and educated in doing research in this space. And I think there's a really cool opportunity to do a lot of research as well. You know, there's a lot of interesting things that we could learn and study, and I would love to bring on really good advisors and also partner with folks that could help us do those studies. Yeah, good question. All right, we got 15 seconds, so we'll do one more quick one. Yeah, really good question. I'll answer it quickly. It was, whenever the phone blocks you from using apps, will you be able to suggest alternatives? You know, you've got 1 minute, you've got 10 minutes, you've got an hour. Yes, what we see is there's kind of this moment of interception, and if you reach in your pocket and you want to scroll, come to Roots, we'll redirect you. You can kind of have a preset list of options of things that you would rather be doing. And yeah, you can filter it by time, so you can kind of take advantage of that. So, yeah, good question.
Let's give it up for Clint with Roots.
Feel about seeing those stats? Am I the only one that's like, oh?
We're literally nudging each other like, oh,
like
my god,
cringing.
I do that.
Like,
oh my
totally
god, I do
cringing.
That. It's okay though. We've
it's
got
like
help.
One thing knowing it, but then seeing the numbers up there, it's like, oh, that's a lot of time.
I know.
A lot of time.
But we've got one more giveaway, and let's give it up for everyone who is here on the stage, because it takes a lot to get up and share your vision and share your company and get feedback and questions.
And I gotta say, you guys are fire tonight with the questions.
Oh, like, my God, Kristen, they're so smart.
So
y'all
good.
Are so smart.
And that's the best thing you can do for a founder. So first and foremost, we practice our pitches, right? Like, we know our pitches, but no one knows what kind of questions they're gonna ask us. So those are always kind of like a wild card, and it helps us a lot refine our business and be able to answer questions that we might not be thinking of. So for you guys asking such really great questions, it really helps these founders. So thank you for being so insightful.
So right before Richard starts, we have one more giveaway. What is a book that you have read recently that has impacted you? What book would you share? Okay, we got someone in the
all
back.
Right.
We've got some people in the front. All right, all right, all right, all right.
I didn't send you with the prize.
Traction by Jeepa Wickman.
What did you like about it?
I mean, it told you how to get traction.
You have one more you want to share? Yes. The Mountain Is You. Ooh, what did you like about that book? Self-sabotage is a big one.
I'm going to have to get myself that.
Okay, well, I see two more. So we're going to take these two more right before Richard goes up. What's yours? Legendary.
Oh, I already started walking, so.
I see it. Last hand in the back. What book would you recommend?
Forgot your.
No Bad Captains? Oh, No Bad Apples. Okay. Okay. Well, we've got lots
That's
of good recommendations.
Yeah.
We'll get you right before the last one. All right, let's give it up for Richard with Super Copy.
All right. Hello. Well, we are Super Copy, and my name is Richard. So we are, our mission is to create a persona-centric AI that helps marketing content happen that's related to your audience. So if you see our team, one of my co-founders is in the crowd here today for Will. Yeah, we're a full-stack team focused on solving something with a very human-centered mind. And that's something we see AI having a lot of play with. So the big problem that we're solving is we realize marketing teams waste a lot of money. How many of you ever wasted money like marketing? All right. That's why we made it. This came from a personal problem of ours because we were creating multiple startups, studios, and we realized every time we talked about marketing, we were in like the five figures minimum. And then to even push it, you need another five figures to push it. I was like, okay, that's $10,000 I don't want to spend. And often, they don't actually promise you conversions. They're like, we'll give you impressions. I'm like, that's not what I need. So we found out often, a lot of the other marketing and law of communication is the same scale. What we found out is like, you have a massive following. I feel like LinkedIn has the same problem. Massive following, very, very little engagement. So we've seen like 0.16% engagement rate, and they thought that was great. And we're like, this is fantastic. And if they're 3 to 5%, that's like God tier. And I'm like, wow, I'm spending money for 97% of the people to never see me. and that's something we kind of approached marketing from a very hardcore engineering standpoint for a bit. And we're like, okay, let's go do some interviews. So we've done 500 plus interviews with marketing departments, communications officers, admins, anyone that's writing copy for somebody. We've done a ton of interviews. And we found out there's a lot of lag between the customer and the content. And sometimes it's just because someone was feeling a certain way that day. And we found out, okay, we need to get the customer data to the content and relate it pretty much instantly. And if we can't do that, by that point, there's a reason, a meme that's like a year old coming out into the stream, like, all right, Amtrak's like, this is a fun meme. Like, yes, from 2018. And we just found out that's not relatable. So we found out there's three pieces that we have to build, which is like a persona-driven AI. We have to somehow generate content from actionable databases and integrate and analyze things. So we use AI as a big aspect. So we found out generic AIs create very generic content. But when you have someone in mind, when you're writing for an audience, that content tends to be a lot better, probably because it's specific. And what we found out was great product and great marketing kind of follows the same thought. If you're building from everybody, you build for nobody. And that's the same thought process we put onto it. And we've actually had quite a bit of uproar whenever we talk about it. So we actually made it really easy to just load up brands, personas, and just load it up. So hey, I'm talking to students. So how many of you have you marketed here before? Marketed. Do you know who you're marketing to? Customers? You say customers? Who are your customers? That's why we made the product. It's often just like, we have customers. I'm like, who are they? Students. What kind of students? That's it. And these are, we're working with senior marketers and we see the same problem. So okay, we gotta make it easy. So if I click Nike, I should be able to load multiple people that fit Nike's demographic. Who am I marketing to? And we just made it very, 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 very specific. And that's kind of where we're going towards. As you can see, it's loading in real time. So you could go see like, hey, these are the weekend warriors, the working professionals, the trendsetters. There's multiple variations, and this is our pretty much an MVP of where we're going towards. A personal library of who you could pick and who you could craft an audience towards. So what we see is everything in the future is going to be personalized, primarily because we have the technology to personalize it with. Unfortunately, every time I talk to marketers, they don't want to personalize 40,000 different emails every week. That's not possible. So with AI, that's very, very possible. So what we see is it's going to be very engaging. There's going to be active filter contents. We're going to skip ads at an insane rate. And the target market's going to be in the trillions, which is always nice. And to finish it up, we started about 8 months ago. We're generating revenue about 4K MRR. And we got Auburn University as one of our major clients. And the good news is they keep coming back every month for more licenses, which is always a win. Yeah. So the big ask is like, we have a free trial, love to check you out. If you have a company or a marketing department or just a founder that wants to talk to their audience a little bit better, please check us out. Thank you.
Let's give it up for Richard with SuperCopy, who has questions for him.
So the question is, how are we naming these personas? So the cool thing is we have personas created for both the brand. So it could be a personal brand, it could be a big brand. And there are needs and wants that we created for it. And based on that, we actually generate people that would want it. So these are completely AI generated. Yes. Mm-hmm. Can you repeat that question? Yes. Yes. Mm-hmm. Okay, that's a very good, that's a really good question. So like, if big brands can't create customized languages to everybody, how are we doing it? Yes. So the cool information is like, they actually have the data often. It's just they don't have the tools to customize it. And if you tell a marketer to customize all the messaging to every message on scale that's at lightning speed, you probably won't have a marketer tomorrow. Like, they'll just leave. But so what we use is we use AIs to fill in the holes. So they have all these pieces, and we kind of make a database out of all of these personas that you could preload, load it up, and these personas will grow with you over time. So you don't lose any of that data when some marketer leaves. Cool. Yes, sir in the white shirt. So that's a very good question. Do we do integrations yet? That is definitely on our product lifecycle that we're like going towards. We are still at product market fit. We're actually discovering customer data segmentation. It's actually one of the biggest things that everyone wanted. Like, they're like, content creations for suckers. I want all the customer data. I'm like, cool, let's do that. So integrations are on the way, analytics are on the way. And yeah, everything is, the more we can measure, the better. Yes in the back. That's yes. The mean feedback, if you're a marketer, you could close your ears. We found out most marketers don't know their audience. And that was like, it's worrisome, but also like, that's why we created the personal finder tool, because like, we'll help you find it. It's like, don't worry, your job's safe. Yes. Yes. So who are our incumbents? So the way we see them is, and our target market. So our target market is, we've realized B2B businesses, enterprise companies tend to do the best. So what we notice, there's internal and external communications. Internal communications is a little easier to get into because there's less of the ego to fight for internal communications. So internal communications, we notice you probably have a 40,000 list of just your employees, and just like updating them alone is very difficult. We're actually not worried about the big guys yet, primarily because we realize they're gonna be Salesforce. I'm not really worried about Salesforce levels of deployment, not yet. I'm like, if you guys can do that 5 years from now, that's totally fine. All about is speed. We want to provide things, and we don't have a lot of weight to it. So that's the big thing that we want to focus on. And for the big guys, if they want to acquire us later down the road, maybe. Yes. So Facebook already does targeting, and that's the question. And how do we have plans for working with that? So the cool thing is Facebook already targets the ad for you, but they don't write the content for you. And if you, the more you know about your audience, the better. So you can actually create content that fits who they're fitting you for. Unfortunately, a lot of people just create generic content and hopefully it fits. Yes. Yes. Yeah, that's a good question. So how are we moving fast in a world of AI that's already moving quickly? I guess this will be the last question. The big thing for us is we're just going to solve problems that really matter to the customers, and that usually works out for us. What we notice is everyone wants to do everything. And that's something that we realize doesn't work, because you're just in this infinite battle of just creating infinite templates. So I'm going to create the lullaby song AI. I'm like, this is becoming dumb. and we see that on scale. So we're just going to get very focused and get very good at it. No one's competing us on the personas level, at least yet. And we just plan on fighting the incumbents when they come.
Let's give it up for Richard with Super Copy.
All right, so now we're gonna get started and bring up the way that you guys can vote. So come go over here. Good job, guys. Huh?
Okay, guys, we're about to open the poll. We're going to let you go to slido.com. It's on the screen, slido.com. Oh,
thank you. We'll bring it up.
Let you get settled there first. Were these not amazing pitches? There's a lot of innovation in Atlanta, man.
Investors, give them your money.
DJT in the back. I feel like you're in like a very vibey mood tonight.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay.
Digging it. While we're getting it up, I do have one more tote. So I want to know, do we ask anyone who's the first? Yeah, we asked the first time already. Who came the furthest? Anyone come far?
Everyone's looking
here?
Like Atlanta.
Over here, California. Oh, I teed that up. They're my friends. It's not every day that we get someone from California visiting us, right? So it was pretty exciting. Yeah, right?
It's on the left. All right.
Still not up, though.
It's not up?
Okay. There we go.
The poll is officially open. Which was your favorite pitch tonight? Select it. We have Perigo, Quickie, Roots, and Super Copy.
We have a timer?
I don't have a timer. DJT has a timer in the back.
I can see the voting.
And
live.
You guys will be in our ATV selfie this evening, so make sure you get those smiles ready after you vote. How long do they have?
Forty-five seconds.
There we go.
There we go.
This is what we're used to. You're queuing us up.
Have you ever been on a game show?
Actually, I have.
Which one?
It wasn't aired. I went to Argentina.
Oh.
My husband got injured. It's okay. But yeah, it was a game show in Argentina.
What was this game show in Argentina?
My Man Can. It's a Korean game show that they brought to Argentina.
That's amazing.
Long story. We'll talk about it later. All right. We've got like 10 seconds left.
Don't forget, the winner tonight goes to the pitch off. $13,000 worth of prizes. I was on the prices, right?
Were you?
Yeah.
You have money?
Yeah. You can Google it.
I want to see it. All right. It's closed. Oh, 5, 4, 3, 2. Okay. We'll do the wrap.
Beep.
Let's give it up for Quickie.
Yes.
Congratulations, Don. You will be in the pitch-off next week. Thank you for everyone who presented. And you guys, let's get our video. Everybody say hey.
Hey.
Thank you so much for coming tonight. Make sure to network. Make sure to connect. Make sure to follow these amazing companies. And we will be back for our pitch-off on June 26th. Thank you so much. Have a great night.
Thank you, everyone.